We'll call the June 7th, 2011 meeting of the Salina Planning Commission to order. First item on the agenda is approval of the summary minutes from the May 17th, 2011 regular meeting. Is there a motion to approve?
So move.
And a second?
Second.
And moved and seconded to approve the minutes of the May 17th, 2011 regular meeting. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? None being heard, motion carries. Item number two, we are going to switch with item number three. So on your agenda, we will go at this time to item number three. It's application Z09-12 filed by the Salina Planning Commission requesting amendment of Article 6 District Regulations by adding Division 10.3 Public Use District. Dean?
Just for clarification, Mr. Chairman, the bylaws of the Planning Commission require that any applicant or an authorized representative for that applicant be present to address questions from the Planning Commission and the public for you to take any action on an item. So as we do not have an applicant present to address item two, we are going to item three, which you are the applicant and you are present. So this item, we have three items that we specifically want to discuss in relation to this, and you have in your packets the use list, and that appears on page three of that staff report. And what we have in your staff report there is we've identified 12 public facility uses as potential permitted uses and eight items that we identified as conditional uses. And we'd like your input on anything that we forgot or should have been included, and also anything you think we have miscategorized between a conditional use permit or a permitted use. Again, the clarification being that if you had a proposal to construct a fire station and that property was not zoned for public use or public facilities, then there would be a public hearing to change. Let's say it was zoned residential and they wanted to construct a fire station, then you would have an application to rezone that property to public facilities or public use district, and so there would be a hearing on it from that standpoint. But if there was a property that had already been laid out and zoned for public facility use, then a construction of a fire station on that property would simply be a building permit issuance. So there would not be any public hearing on that. The way that it is set up today, fire stations and items like that are conditional uses within residential districts, and so you would apply for a conditional use permit to construct a new fire station and you'd have a hearing there. But the problem we run into with that is the same thing that Mr. Kennedy has run into with educational related things. When you have your educational and public facilities in a residential district, it doesn't it's not a perfect fit. So we think that we can do better by having something that's customized just for public facilities. So we felt like things like a public athletic stadium or a cemetery or a jail or detention facility or a new public arena, a public works maintenance facility. Let's say that the maintenance facility on East Ash were relocated to a different location, then they would need to get a conditional use permit for that because they've got storage of heavy equipment and salt and chemicals and different things like that. If anybody proposed a new or expanded sanitary landfill, that would be conditional. In any kind of supplemental wastewater treatment plant or water treatment plant, those would be conditional uses, and those would be uses I think that most residents would want to get some public notice of and have a hearing on. But that is the distinction on the public facility side, is that those uses that you see 1 through 12 if you had public use zone property, let's say that the result is that Kenwood Park and Oakdale Park become zoned public use and somebody wants to build one of these things there, those would be permitted.
Dean, I know we've seen this list before, but it seems to me that the zoo would have a pretty high impact on wherever that was due to noise and smell and things like that. Why would that not be a conditional use?
It could very well be. When we had the discussion before, zoos were brought up as something that we had omitted, and there seemed to be a little bit of a consensus that that should be permitted like parks or playgrounds, but I would agree that it could fall because of, if it was large enough, traffic or the presence of animals or odors or things like that. That's certainly reasonable if you thought that should be conditional instead of permitted.
Anybody have any thoughts on that? Or am I being overly sensitive?
I had the same thought.
Gee, after last meeting, I can't imagine us being.
Well, good. Is everybody okay then with putting that in the conditional use side? Is that?
I think so.
Okay. And then the other question, I mean, sometimes we look at this too long or too close, and there might be some use to you that's obvious that's a public operation or activity the city might be involved with that we just flat missed. But again, we have a community publicly owned animal shelter. We have an aquatic center that would be broad enough to include any kind of pool, community centers, fire stations. We have a municipal golf course. We have a wide variety of governmental buildings and offices. We do not have an indoor recreation center, but it's been discussed off and on. Neighborhood center would be like Carver Center or facilities like that. Obviously, we've addressed public parks and playgrounds, and if Martha Tasker were here, she'd be reminding you that we have 58 different pump station locations around the community, many of which the city owns the land that those pump stations sit on. So we've tried to address that, and zoos was one that came up. But that, like I said, if you can think of an activity that the city's involved in that those don't cover, then that would be part of the input. And
the spray park and the skateboard, what does that fall under?
I would put it under public parks and playgrounds.
Okay. That's what I was thinking.
My thought, or all the concern and under educational facilities, it seems that the bus barns and the maintenance facilities are very different from the other three as far as being next door to something, and whether they're automatically permitted no matter where they want to go, I think is something to at least think about.
I might say that maintenance certainly is one that's oftentimes located pretty close to our other facilities on larger areas. Like, we have maintenance operations at Central right now, limited scale. Our maintenance facility where it's located is a downtown business right now. And so I think that needs to stay part of it, permitted, because otherwise, Kansas Wesleyan, Salina Technical College, K-State, those kind of areas would have maintenance facilities embedded into their operations.
Right.
We don't store large equipment typically, so it fits pretty neatly. But bus barns might be, that might be something we want to discuss. That's a different, bigger operation, of course. When you're talking about bus barns, you're talking about bus storage as well.
The school district does not have a bus barn per se now, isn't the most of the buses are out at the Durham property out on West State Street.
Well, but that's not actually correct, because see, with Kennedy Heartland, we store buses on site for that preschool operation, and without them there, we'd be crippled. So,
yeah, and I think,
and we do have bus operations out of there, and a little building, I guess you could call a bus barn, but it's like a storage building. But
and they all are inside the building.
They're set outside, and they're in a fenced area, but they sit outside, so, and we about have to have, and many school districts store their buses on site of the facility, because that's where you move out of in the morning. So, for example, it wouldn't be unusual to have buses at Central High School, where you, a big lot there, where you leave them overnight, rather than having them out of town like we do. Only because Durham is our contractor, do we probably have a separate facility now? That's a question we need to look at.
Yeah, what we tried to do in that was to, in the thing about schools and also to a degree churches and worship facilities, is that you've got the core use, which is the school, but you also have a number of what we described here as related support facilities and uses. And I guess that's where we need to, why we called that out separately. We would anticipate that if you had an elementary or intermediate school or secondary school, that you would have accessory bus parking, you would have you might have a garage or accessory building that would be used to store snow plows and things like that. The intention was that if you had that type of thing, that would fall into the category of related support facilities and uses. Where we were needing some help was, as we understand it, USD 305 currently has a maintenance facility that's downtown on Fifth Street. And so if you had a freestanding maintenance facility, the question would be, is it appropriate to locate that on a site that is zoned for educational facilities as a freestanding use as opposed to accessory to a school, and then the same with bus barns. And so that's where we need your help. Because the other way to look at it is that many school districts have administrative offices, and then they have bus barns and maintenance facilities located with the administrative offices. And so that, I think USD 305 is actually a little unusual in that regard, in that there's administrative offices over on Gypsum, and then we've got maintenance facilities over on Fifth Street, and then you've got Durham Transportation has a number of buses out on State Street. But if you looked at this from the standpoint of USDA 305 was going to create an administrative campus, and then what activities would you expect that to have at that campus, administrative offices, bus barns, and maintenance facilities would probably all fit within that.
Well, I'm just thinking about, take Metalark for example. There's a parking lot where teachers and administrators park.
Correct.
And so I assume that automatically falls under the will fall into the educational facilities district. And if they decided that instead they wanted to park buses there, I think the neighborhood would see that differently than administrators, teachers parking their cars there. Or if Central High, what would happen, for example, if Central, they decided Central needed a place to park buses, so they bought property to the west, a row of those homes there or part of those homes, to make that into a parking lot for buses. What would the process for that be? Because it's not, I assume, now it's zoned R1, I assume. Mm-hmm. So what would the process be?
Well, our present interpretation would be that if you are an elementary school or middle school or high school, that it should be reasonable to expect that at those sites there would be some accessory parking of school buses that are related to, we have children bused to Oakdale, we have children's bused to the Kennedy Heartland programs. It would seem to us that the parking of buses would be a reasonable accessory use to a public or private school. I guess what we would need to focus on or discuss is, Our idea of what a bus barn is where the place where the district houses all its buses not in use and where they might perform maintenance or upkeep or things like that, have a service garage where they would work on their fleet. So
saying as a property, as a homeowner,
right,
that would not be my assumption.
Okay, in terms of the accessory parking and buses?
That one day I would see buses all summer long or...
But we currently,
at a school site?
If you were a homeowner,
at a school site.
If you were a homeowner at Kennedy, you would see that right now.
Right.
Yeah. And it's already there, and we have to be able to operate that way. Short of that, we can't function.
Right, I understand. I just think that...
It's just that we've not had that at other schools, but I can tell you many schools have that as part of their day-to-day operations because that's where the buses have to come and go from, and it's logical that that becomes their home sometimes.
Okay. But again, if the school district bought R1 property across, say, from Central, then that would have to be rezoned to Educational Facilities District?
Yes.
And then would
you
that...
You are correct. I think your observation is correct, as if you took Meadowlark School and the campus and it were designated as an educational facility zoning, and you took the accessory parking area on the north side of the street there and also zoned it for educational facilities, and bus barns were listed as a permitted use, then if the school district wished to locate a bus barn there, and maybe, you know, what needs to be done is to have a better definition of what a bus barn consists of. But I guess one option would be to say that if you had administrative, if you had school district administrative offices, that bus barns and maintenance facilities could be located in association with that. You could say that if you had just had a freestanding bus barn by itself on a piece of property or a freestanding maintenance facility, that would be a separate conditional use. That would be one option. But I think part of what this is trying to do is to allow for or even encourage the campus type approach of concentrating or putting on a campus the various activities of the school district, and you have to focus on that. It's the same thing that you have out at South High, recreational sports fields for softball. You also have a sports field that has a track and is used for practice. We, if looking at this proposal, we would consider those to be related support facilities and uses for the school. If you wanted to construct a athletic stadium that had permanent seating and was used to host athletic events, that was lighted and had permanent seating then and public address system and all that, then that's what we would consider in the conditional use category. So maybe we need to do a little bit of defining there, but I'll also want to ask Mr. Kennedy whether we missed any uses or activities that you would associate in your experience with educational facility operations.
Now I read through those. I think that at least what I know, it encompasses most of what we would try to accomplish at a school site and what I see being our school sites being used as now. I think it's pretty all-inclusive.
Yeah, hey. So
I don't know that I can speak for, I don't know if I can speak for other institutions. I can, you know, I'm trying to think what some of the, will this cover educational facilities? Will this cover the private schools as well? I mean, so we're talking about Sacred Heart or not? Probably not.
You were going to pull them.
Those because
yeah,
of church
what we were going to do is at the point at which we would get to the point of having the body of a district and the full content, then we would send that to them, contact them, and ask them if they were interested in having that as part of having their property as part of that designation. So when we use the term public and private, it was designed to include Salina Christian Academy, Sacred Heart facilities like that, that would all have similar uses. But I guess if you had a, if the school district went out and built a, or bought a piece of property and said, we want to construct a new administrative office facility and have our bus barn and maintenance facility on the same campus with us, all in as one campus, and they applied to zone that property educational facilities district to accommodate that, that seems to be one scenario. If you had just scattered individual pieces of property, that you'd have a bus barn here and a maintenance facility there, then that might be a different story. So there might be a way that you could list the bus barn or maintenance facility as permitted if it were located on a campus in association with administrative offices, and then listed as conditional if it was freestanding. But I don't know how to address the parking of buses at Kennedy Heartland or places like that, because from staff's perspective, that is a reasonable accessory use of a school property that has children coming in and going on buses, that some of the buses are going to have to be stationed there to come and go. And for us, we think we can distinguish between a bus barn or bus maintenance facility that has dozens of buses versus a school site that has a handful of buses that are used daily.
Commissioner Kennedy, given the legislature's position on funding education right now, looking down the road, is the flexibility factor when it comes to being able to jockey facilities and have them have different uses, is that something that's going to be important to the district in the future?
You look at a district the size of Salina, that flexibility is pretty critical for some of our bigger campuses, such as Central and South. There just doesn't exist in communities places to go with some of those things that you have to make a school district run. Just as you see, the city has to use certain areas in town that for operations that you wouldn't typically think might be there. There just isn't a place to go with them. So, yeah, that flexibility is going to be pretty critical. I see Sydney's point, though, concerning a bus maintenance facility that has 40 buses running in and out of Metal Arc would be a little bit, I would see, probably not exactly what you'd want to see happening there either. Would we ever have to do that? I would hope not, but...
If the freestanding facility was made a conditional use, but the having a bus barn as part of another operation someplace, is that something that would?
I don't know that I would have a real problem with making, and Dean would have a better handle on this too. We've talked about this, a bus barn as a conditional use in educational facilities, bus maintenance facility as a conditional use, and. But I don't want to get us to a situation where it precludes leaving five or six buses at an elementary school if we need to transport children. That's kind of the difference. I don't think anybody wants to see 40 buses running in and out all day long out of Metal Arc, for example, or Cottonwood or anywhere else. But I think that we need to be able to leave a few there if we have to for transportation of those kids. So how we structure that, I don't know. But I'm agreeable that on a full-scale bus operation, such as Durham, on West State Street, that needs to be a conditional use and get it approved based on the nature of the where it's going to be. If it's related to administrative offices and food service, all that makes some sense to have it there. Mm-hmm. If it's related to elementary school operation, maybe not. Does that make some sense?
Yeah.
Dean, is there a way to creatively put that into language that would?
I think so. The what we struggled with. And which it's planner's favorite language is included but not limited to But what we're trying to address there is to say, okay, USD 305 wants to add a greenhouse to South High. Shouldn't they? It's hard to write an ordinance to anticipate all those things, but shouldn't you expect that you have a school site, you're going to have gymnasiums, you're going to have outdoor fields, you're going to have, if you're a high school, you might have a greenhouse or some kind of vocational shop or something like that. We could identify that as accessory parking of school buses or accessory overnight parking of school buses. But given the fact that we're saying that the city's maintenance facilities and yard should be a conditional use, it's probably reasonable to do that for the school district as well. But if they had a site that was not zoned for educational facilities, they could apply to change the zoning and for a conditional use permit for that facility at the same time. What it addresses is the scenario that Commissioner Soderbergh identified, which is, well, we've got this piece of property that we've now rezoned to educational facility at Meadowlark. Is that now open that up to a bus barn without any public notice? So I think we could address that by clarifying that accessory parking or overnight parking of school buses is a related support facility and use, and then we could slide the bus barns and maintenance facilities. We still believe that administrative offices are awfully similar to a school, and if you have an educational facility zone property, you ought to be able to put administrative offices on it, just like you could any other governmental building or offices. The second part of this, wanted to address, John, if you could go to the slide that has the residential zone signs and go down to the last part. This is the language we have in our residential section.
I don't think it's
here. And we would look to transfer this over to the educational facilities section, or at least call this back. But it says, in addition to churches, schools, nursing homes, rehabilitation centers, YMCAs, parks and recreation facilities, athletic fields can have the electronic changeable copy sign. That if we look at the sign structure, the message center part cannot exceed 50% of the total sign area. The sign must be at least 10 feet back from the street. You can set it at 45 degrees at an angle. It can't be taller than 8 feet. And we've got the dimmers and the timing restrictions on it. The part that's not within this section is the portion that limits any one sign to 32 square feet. And so what we were looking for input on here as far as the educational facilities district, if Central Stadium or the stadium there at Central High Campus were zoned educational facility and they wish to put up a electric or electronic changeable copy sign, right now you'd be limited to 8 feet height and 32 square feet of total sign area, which might be pretty limiting if you were having a stadium that had a number of public events or things that you were trying to promote. So this language, all this in here, was really put in here for the elementary school scale sign, the Cottonwoods, the Oakdales, the Coronados. You got homes across the street. You may not be on an arterial street. So the two things that we see as limiting or what could be modified and brought back would be to look at the school facilities, particularly the secondary school facilities that tend to have more activities, and enlarging the height limit, and also increasing the size limitation to allow something larger than 32 square feet. But before we went there, we wanted to remind you of what this took us from having no ability to have the electronic changeable copy sign or bulletin board sign to having a sign like this, which fits your elementary school site but may not work for the central campus or South High campus. Are there any thoughts about the height, style, size of having and leaving this pretty much intact, but having a subcategory for the athletic facilities or the secondary schools?
I'll jump in. Part of what we do, obviously, in the sign business is we try to make signs fit the architectural scape and scope of the facility that they're going to be at. That's on the selling side of things. As the planning commissioner hat goes on, then, of course, I try to look at things like impact to neighbors and stuff like that. Let's say Central, for example, if you were going to put a sign there, I think you'd want something that 8 foot tall is not very tall. And if you're talking about a 32 square foot sign, that's only the bottom of it, 4 feet off the ground. So you've got a pretty small audience to play
well,
to.
The other part of that is that we say that the electronic message center portion
only
can only be
that.
50%.
Yeah.
So
you got a 2 foot by eight or a 4 foot by 4 foot sign. You got a small area there. So as a realistic part of what those signs do for the public, they are information systems. They are information for students and parents and for the community. And as many of you know, they can also be tied to the Amber Alert system and have a big value in that respect. But again, putting my planning commissioner hat back on, as a realistic thing, I would say maybe double what those specifications are. 64 square feet is still pretty small sign. And then height, whatever we thought, you know, was reasonable, but 10, 12 feet would not be out of line, I don't think, at all.
If it were C3, what would the height, would the height limitation, C3, C5, either one of those zoning, what would that be?
If you had C3 zoning, you could have a sign height of 30 feet.
Wow. That might be a little taller than we need. I mean, I'm not thinking we need anything quite that. We're not trying to advertise a school from 70 blocks away. We're trying to share information from people
and
close.
And just to give you perspective, because they are zoned C5 and they're one of the few businesses that's taken advantage of it, the McDonald's at Crawford and Ohio have historically had a 50-foot tall pole sign so that if you come over the hill at Marymount and Crawford, you can see it right away.
See, it's a little different if you think of Central, because its front sets on Crawford, which is really in a C3, C5
right.
district.
You have Elmore Center across the street.
Or South is across the street from more residential. Mm-hmm. And so the two are a little bit different, both on main thoroughfares, but it needs to be a little taller than what's there, I'm sure. I just know what the height might be.
You have the two competing things of providing sufficient time to take in the information versus the issue of distraction.
Right.
But the fact that you can drive 40 miles an hour on Ohio or 35 on Crawford means that you almost need a bigger display area in order to get the information conveyed. Again, everything that's in here is with the idea that you're driving on a 25-mile-an-hour residential street with houses nearby, and you're trying to keep it understated. But you have Magnolia Road, which is busy. You have Crawford, which is busy and has high travel speeds. And then you've got the stadium, which is an active place. So we were going to our main questions there were, if you looked at Central, South, or the stadium, right now schools are limited to having ground signs. There's a limit to how tall you can make a ground sign, although if you look at the Bank 6 sign out on South Ohio, we call that a ground sign because it has no pole. It starts at the ground, and it's about 20-some feet tall. So on the other hand, most of the signs I've seen associated with schools or things of that nature are sitting or mounted on a pole or set of poles. So if we looked at the high school sites or whether we're talking about the aquatic center or any other public type facility, what I told Mr. Kennedy is that we have basically the city has written its own special rules for the Bicentennial Center and its sign. And whatever we have that is educational related or similarly related on a public use should be similarly situated. But the sign at the Bicentennial Center is a pole sign, and it's fairly large, and it's electronic message center, and they advertise off-premise businesses there. So would the commission be open to looking at those high school sites or the stadium sites as places where pole signs would be allowed if we had a height cap? I mean, 20 feet or something like that might be more acceptable than 30. So, and then you'd mentioned right now you're limited to 32 square feet with 50% of the sign area limitation. You threw out 64 square feet. Are there any thoughts either on a square footage or getting rid of the 50% limitation? In other words, the idea is that you would have a static sign that would say Cottonwood Elementary as part of that, and then underneath that you would have this reader board that would talk about events or things at the school. But you could envision a sign at Central or South that might be 100% reader board and not have anything else.
I think it needs to be that way.
We have been designing a lot more signs like that with a much smaller amount of static message and then larger reader boards, mainly because the facilities are using a cell or a space in there just for their own information. In other words, like, let's say Central again, we'll use that as an example. They might have a schedule up there. They might have coming activities, and then might be a Central High logo and some Mustangs.
But I'm real hard-pressed to understand why some place like Holiday Manor that is embedded completely in a residential area needs a sign that size. It's intrusive to a neighborhood.
We're talking about leaving this just as it is, but pulling out for purposes of the educational facilities district only.
I thought you were pointing out that this section needed
no,
to change.
No. This is for just
okay.
Don't worry about your hair.
This.
Well, but then, what about schools that are completely embedded within?
Well, what we would do, we would reference this and pull it into the educational facilities and public use district. But then we would have a supplement or addendum to this that would just address the athletic fields and the secondary schools.
Or the bigger signs you're talking
or
about.
Or the bigger signs.
Yes. But I'd not any other
not
schools.
For the elementary.
So not any other uses, not YMCAs, not...
Okay.
We were lukewarm as a staff about the whole nursing home, rehab center, assisted living, other than the fact that they were all conditional uses and we treated all the conditional uses equally. What we're talking about is if you are zoned EF and you're Meadow Lark School, this is what you live by. What we're talking about is supplementing this to say for the athletic fields or stadiums or the secondary school sites, then you could go beyond the 8-foot height and you could go beyond the 32 square feet, but just for those locations.
And not Lakewood.
Well, I was going to ask that question, because here's if we talk about secondary in our district, we mean middle school and high school. That's just terminology used in 305.
So Most places talk about secondary. You don't like our intermediate schools?
Well, I don't know. It's just the terminology they've used. Most places call secondaries or high school. But that's so. My thought would be Lakewood would be more likely to have a taller sign and a bigger sign if we had someplace out front to put it. We don't have any property because it's on Ohio.
But south
would not be appropriate for a pole sign.
Right.
So I would suggest if we do this, we leave it right now at the high schools with athletic facilities and then make it a conditional provision that middle schools could apply for and be considered. Lakewood might be considerable. I don't think South Middle would.
We use, and maybe we got to look at it from that standpoint too, we use this terminology because in our parking ordinance, we have one set of parking requirements for elementary and intermediate schools where students don't drive, and then we have another set of standards for secondary schools.
You're just talking about high school in your ordinances, right?
Okay. So what we were trying to do when the reason we were calling elementary and intermediate and putting them in the same classification is for us that means elementary and middle school. And secondary means high school
only. That's fine.
Only.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, I think that's reasonable.
But in your experience, Mr. Mike Sell, for making signs for different school districts or educational entities, what do you see as a norm for sign area for those types of things?
Well, we have people that are dropping the static part of the sign completely. I still think that I did a little design work for USD 305, and it had a small portion in there that was for the schools and a static message, and then the rest of it. But I would say probably maybe a 75-25 type of a thing might be appropriate.
I mean, total, when we cap a sign at 32 square feet, what would you be envisioning? If you went from 8 feet to 20 feet, what would be a proportional increase in sign area from 32 square feet to what, to keep it in proportion?
Well, as a practical matter, you can get a tremendous amount of information on a 6x9, the digital sign that's out at Phillips is roughly 6 foot by 9 foot, and there's a tremendous amount of information you can get out there, and so I would say
64 square feet would not be unreasonable.
No, not at all. I would say maybe cap the whole thing at 75 and 64 for the digital portion, whatever that comes out to percentage wise.
I think that makes sense. I don't think we want anything ever bigger than that.
Well, the other issue is
couldn't afford it.
Yeah, that's going to say that's the other issue. The economic.
We'll be getting one about this big if we're messing with school finance.
Yeah, make that a jumbo drawing if you want to. It doesn't matter.
Like it's central proportionately. If that were a commercial business, that would certainly be smaller than any commercial business.
That would be smaller than what they would be allowed by both by size and by height.
And certainly, I don't ever expect that I would want my educational facilities to take on the same persona as a business facility.
But part of this, and I don't know if we'll get to it, we did talk about the issue of will we ever be allowed to use off-site product advertisement on these signs. And I'm a believer. We don't do it. Our policy doesn't allow it yet. But I'm hopeful someday that we'll be forced to give that some consideration.
Well, there are certainly other facilities doing that. Sacramento State College right now has a very large digital sign on the freeway right there, and they sell about every third or fourth ad is a commercial ad.
Something tells me if we followed the Sacramento model, we'd end up in court. But what Sacramento did is they banned private electronic message board signs, but you can only put them on public right-of-way or public property. And therefore, the city of Sacramento or the other public minis get the income.
I'm kind of thinking, let's talk about that a little bit.
Yeah,
that would that mean McDonald's sign would have to move down to Central?
There you go.
Just kidding.
So yes, the way it's set up in Sacramento, if McDonald's wanted to have an electronic message board sign, they'd have to put it on public property and pay rent. But what I just wanted to point out that, and it's not worded very artfully, but advertising signs are signs that we define as advertising products and services that are not available on the site are prohibited in the C3 district except for the Salina Bicentennial Center. And so that's probably not a very defensible way to do that. So most of the advice we see talks about time, place, and manner, which would get to height, size, brightness, things like that, and not regulate what the actual sign says. So if, I think under this scenario, what you could envision is if you drive by the Bicentennial Center, you're likely to see a sign that's advertising the Ramada Inn or Coca-Cola or something like that, and it's been that way for years. But if I had another C3 zoned property like Dillon's would not be able to advertise another business somewhere else in the community or sell space to that, and that's probably not well defensible. I think the other thing, John, we wanted to, if you could go to the hospital medical regulations. This is the last time that we added a district, and what we would do is we would have one of these for each. We'd have one for public uses, one for educational facilities, and one for the exposition, which we would see mostly used at Kenwood Park, or if the county ever gets their own expo center somewhere else, then you would have that as zoning. But you can go ahead and scroll, John, so that each sub-use would have its permitted uses and its conditional uses. And then format-wise, if you could stop there, John, what we did was we tried to address most of these are conventional. But one of the things that was unique about the hospital medical district is we actually had a minimum structure height that said all the buildings they built had to be at two stories or more in height because we didn't want them spreading out. We wanted them to go vertical, and they wanted to be encouraged to go vertical. But I can't, unless Mr. Kennedy can think of something, I can't think of something particularly unique the school district would have structure-wise or height-wise or anything that would, or setback-wise, that would be particularly unique. But you could keep scrolling, John. So don't go too, you could go back, John, to setbacks. So again, we knew where the hospital was present and would be in the future, so we addressed things like allowing or requiring no setback on Santa Fe, having rear yards based on whether that you are abutting a residential district or historic district, greater setback for greater heights. We allowed parking garages to have 100% lot coverage, and we had pretty aggressive lot coverage for the hospital related facilities. What we did was basically a little different than some of the areas. We had a minimum landscaped area, and then we had a section that dealt with the exterior boundaries. So I guess the other questions we'd have on the other items that we have to address in every zoning district that we discuss is we have traditionally on conditional use permits for the school district and for public facilities and churches, landscaping has been required, or front yard landscaping anyway, required as part of that. So would it be safe to assume that public use district would be included in the list of uses that have landscaping as opposed to our I-2 and I-3 where you're exempt?
Absolutely.
And then the probably goes the other aspect. The main differences is I-2 and I-3 don't require landscaping. They don't require paved parking, but all of our other districts do. So I'm going to assume that you would expect that this district would have paved parking and landscaping for all of our public uses. So we will enhance that a little further and bring you back some specific things to vote on as it relates to the sign language. But is there anything where I can't recall lot coverage or setback or things of that nature we've run into with school projects? I think primarily it's been having uses or activities or things that don't readily fit. I think the other thing is that we have some of our lot coverage things and setbacks, when you apply those, don't necessarily fit. So I think we'd be looking more towards the 50% lot coverage as opposed to our residential 30-35%.
Definitely.
And have those things apply. But if Mr. Kennedy can live with us calling middle schools intermediate schools for consistency, then we'll leave that way.
And lot coverage, you're saying, would be 50% on educational facilities, regardless
right. and,
of whether it's elementary
school. And public uses.
And public uses.
Right, as opposed to what we've run into, the only thing I can think of that we've run into, and even to a degree with churches, is what works, a 30-35% lot coverage works for houses and residential districts, but it doesn't always work for churches or educational facilities. So allowing a little bigger footprint, or especially when we're talking about campuses that have multiple
right.
buildings, gymnasiums and greenhouses and things like that.
Yeah.
And just for clarification, maybe it was in here, but I don't remember. Kansas Wesleyan?
We already have a university zoning district, okay. And the areas that are zoned university are K-State Salina, the technical mm-hmm. school, which I still want to call VOTEC, which is not the correct term anymore, and Kansas Wesleyan.
And St. John's is what?
I don't believe St. John's. I believe that is a residential designation, although I can double check that. And the Marymount Administration Building and the Kansas Highway Patrol are still zoned university. And that works for those owners, and it still allows for the diversity of uses. The patrol is mostly a training facility, so that works. And with what Mr. Mars is attempting to do up there at Marymount, the university zoning works for him. So we will take these things and take it one step at a time, but I would anticipate that if you're comfortable, you could have something that you could make a formal recommendation on for a full public use district. It has three components, and then we will have to meet and maybe get a map displayed up here and identify all those facilities on there as the public uses and see what we're going to map.
Good.
Okay. And as far as item two, The applicant is a daycare provider and forgot to make arrangements to have somebody cover so she could attend. So we would, if you want to go back to item two, we should have a motion to continue that item to your June 21st meeting.
Okay. We're back on item number two. Is there a motion to continue this application to the next meeting?
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
Been moved and seconded to move application CU11-2 filed by Deborah Porter to the next available meeting. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? None being heard. Motion carries. Other matters?
On other matters, you have at your place a stapled packet there. And the top of that stapled packet is a letter from Darvin Dent, a partner in the Landmark Development Company. And we had reported to you at a previous meeting in the spring that we'd be bringing you a final plat of Wheatland Hills addition. And so an application was filed, and that application was for a very small portion of the total 36 acres. And John, I guess if you want to put the Wheatland Hill addition summary up there, we can start with that. But it turned out that the primary concern or motivation for Landmark Development is that they did not want to lose their place or their status of having an approved preliminary plat and preliminary zoning approval. And so what occurred was in June of 2009, based on your recommendation, the City Commission approved an ordinance that rezoned the property there at the northeast corner of Holmes and Crawford to R1 for single family and PDD R2.5 for multifamily housing. And they also approved an ordinance on first reading subject to final platting. So what normally occurs is if we take Stone Lake or similar projects like that or Grand Prairie, for an example, they come to you, they get a preliminary plat approved, they go to the City Commission says we concur with the recommendation of how this property should be zoned and developed. They go back to their engineers and surveyors, they develop a final plat, and they bring that back to you, the plat's approved. They then have lots to sell when the lot it's recorded, and obviously they go to work on installing the public improvements. And the reasoning for that, and we've kind of summarized that on page 3 of the staff report, which is page 4 of your stapled items there. They came to us and we had two meetings this spring and said, well, we really don't want to plat this property and we're really not ready to develop and commit to the public infrastructure, but we only did it because we didn't want to lose the status of our preliminary plat. And so what we have, and I think we have it's the next slide, John, about the effective period. This is what our subdivision regulations say, and it squares with our zoning status. Is again, you go to the City Commission and you get first reading on a zoning change and annexation, and then the final approval all comes with a final plat, second reading of the zoning, and second reading of the annexation, and everything is complete. Where we are with Wheatland Hills is that they have preliminarily received zoning approval and preliminarily been approved for annexation, but they haven't yet. So they're actually in limbo, and the property itself is still in Saline County and it's zoned agricultural. So the subdivision regulations say if you have a preliminary plat approved, it's effective for a period of 1 year. And at the end of that time, you need to have obtained final plat approval. You can request extensions. And if you don't do any of that within the time period, then you're required basically to restart the process. So I'll give you an example. Out on Markley Road, we have Magnolia Hills Estates. And they came to you, I believe it was in 2005, with a preliminary plat and a rezoning request, an annexation request for Magnolia Hills Estates number 2. That preliminary plat was approved by you. They were given a year to final plat the property. They looked at the housing market and said, you know what, we're not going to final plat the property, and they withdrew all their applications. What that means is that if they come back with plans to develop the property, there'll be a new public hearing. They'll start with a new preliminary plat, a new request to zone and annex the property. Landmark Development does not wish to do that. So you have the balance here of the developer having gone through the preliminary plat and public hearing process and not wanting to do so again, balanced by the thought that conditions change over time, ownership changes, communities change over time, and it's really not a good public policy to have a preliminary plat that's approved in 1967 still be good in the present when nothing's ever been done to finalize it. So we researched a number of communities, model regulations. They all have the 12-month period in them. We also did some research and found that several jurisdictions, including some formerly high-growth areas, have gone in and through this extension process changed this to allow from a 12-month period to a 36-month period to keep the work that's been done in the preliminary plat as still valid. So what you have is a request for an additional extension, and we think additional extensions are reasonable given the current climate, but having a indefinite or forever extension, it just doesn't seem supportable or a good idea. So in conjunction with this, and I'm not sure you've got have all the, if you can maybe go to your last drawing, John, the last drawing on your slides, the last one you have on your list there. And zoom that up a little bit, but this is what we have, and so we have, this is already developed, the First Christian Church is here, this is Presbyterian Manor, Todd Welsh owns this, First Christian Church owns this, Todd Welsh owns this, this is what we're talking about. We also met with Todd Welsh at that meeting. And attached to this is basically a duplicate report and request, because these two are really in need of staying on the same track. And then at the meeting, we also brought in Overland Property Group, and they're still digesting information. But this is the request area here, and the difference is, the city limits today is right here. This is not in. This is in, and it was brought in intentionally with working with city staff so that landmark development would not be a non-contiguous leapfrog parcel. So basically, what we said we were doing is work with these owners to build a bridge to get them to annex out to here so that we could then work with this parcel. So John, you have a slide there that has backbone infrastructure. It's the third one. And we may need to rotate that. Okay, so, and this, you may find some of these numbers eye-popping, and if you do, that's good because it's educational for what actual costs are. But these, when you look at what needs to be done, and this includes basically taking Holmes Road and paving it north from Crawford up to the north edge of the property. But if you had those, that project, getting the backbone of the water system out, sanitary sewer extensions, these would be the proportionate share of the costs for those various infrastructure improvements. And so if you have people in different and parties in different states of readiness, then it's difficult. What you need to do is get either 51% of the owners or 51% of the area to join in. And if Wheatland Hills wishes to get started and nobody else is ready, then basically they have to be prepared to pick up some of the proportionate costs of the others, making them free riders, so to speak. So what Landmark Development would like to do is keep their preliminary plat alive. You granted an extension of 1 year last July, which means that their extension expires July 5th of this year. And so we've got a typo there on your page 3. The first option is supposed to be to grant a 24-month time extension to July 2nd, 2013. The second option would be to grant a 12-month time extension, which would be to July 3, 2012. And the third option would be to deny the applicant's request for a time extension, which would mean that basically on July 5th, all their applications would expire and they would need to resubmit new zoning and preliminary plat applications. And so you can kind of see the balance that on the one hand you have the developer that says, I did all this work, I went through the public notice and hearing process, I've gotten these zoning designations approved preliminarily and I don't want to lose those. The flip side of that is if that is just allowed to hang out there forever, then you get new people in the neighborhood or the neighborhood changes and they have no idea that that is there and they have no opportunity to get notified when things start up again because all the public hearings have already been held even if it was 10 years ago. So that's the balance. So we believe that the 12 or 24-month extension is reasonable given the current economic situation. We don't believe that having an indefinite or forever preliminary plat out there is reasonable. So I'd be happy to address any questions that you have, but the companion to this is the also a request from Mr. Welsh to basically keep his property and project on the same review timelines what you decide for Wheatland Hills. And since we had this letter and we'd had the meetings, the developers are not here and present. If you wanted to hear something from them directly or question them, then we could arrange for that to occur on your meeting the 21st. But since we had the letter and we had the information, we are presenting this information to you today.
Dean, our statute says that we're allowed to grant 1 6-month extension the way it is right now. So what's the mechanism that we're going outside of that?
Basically looking at the current economic conditions and the hardship.
And we can do that with just a vote?
We can do that with a vote because you've already gone beyond it already.
Okay.
First year.
Yeah, we've already done it.
And really, you the only thing you can't do, at least the way we see your authority, is to repeal that without formal action, to say that there's no time limit at all. But we think it's within your purview to look at the individual circumstances.
Certainly.
And to do extensions that fit with the circumstances. So again, we have a typo in there. It should be 24-month extension to 2013 or a 12-month extension. But I think that you can see from the numbers there that you've got to have probably, we think, the Overland Ventures Group ready to do something on the north side of Brookwood to really make anything real out here, and they were just presented with these numbers and they're digesting them.
Did you get any kind of sense from Todd Welsh or the other group, Darvin Dent's group, as to what 12 month or 24 month would that be? Was one of them more realistic option over the other one?
I personally believe that if we said 12 months, we might be back here again talking about it next summer. So it seems to me that the 24 months is more prudent. As I said, I went in and looked at some communities and jurisdictions in Montana that had a real boom and then a bust, and that's what they were doing, is that they were going in and allowing preliminary plats to have a 36-month life instead of 12 months because of the economic downturn.
Dean, I'm going to make a motion for the 24-month extension, but I'm going to make that in the hope that they're able to put this together, because I see some real future and potential and development east in Salina. There's really no place else to go with affordable housing right now until we address some water situations, and I don't see the city stepping forward to do that yet. So I hope that these people are successful in developing out that way, so there will be future for growth in our community, which I think we all hope. So with that being said, I make a motion we grant the 24-month extension of time to July 2nd, 2013.
Second.
Is that for both
and that
the
would
properties?
Apply to both the Welsh?
Yes, definitely apply to both the Welsh.
Or Z08-11 and P08-9?
Correct.
Okay. It's been moved and seconded. There was a second, right?
Yeah.
Okay. To approve a 24-month extension for application Z08-11 and P08-9 to July 2nd of 2013. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? None being heard, motion carries.
Okay, we will inform them by letter of your action, and we will meet on the 21st, and it is our hope that we will not have a meeting on July 5th, and you'll get a free pass there, but we do see a need. It is possible that Mr. Bankston may have findings of fact for you to review on the 21st. We'll have the Porter case. We'll have a further enhancement of the public and educational facilities items, and we have located the April 21st video, and I'm going to view that and decide if it's worth any follow-up with you. Did want to note that the BFR Metals has purchased the former Midwest siding property to the west of their current property on West State Street, and they have an application in to put a truck scale there, and so that would certainly be an indicator of desire to have loaded loads enter that property through the where the truck scale is located. But we're working with them on that right now, but they have acquired that additional property to the west.
Well, good. We'll be interested to see that. No other matters. We are adjourned.